Thank you so much, Paras, for being here talking to us. Now, the big question, because see, we are neighbors, but we've known very little about you in terms of Nepal cricket. So just walk me through. No, that's how I want to actually start. Talk me through Nepal cricket and what cricket means in Nepal and just the whole journey.
It's been a bit of a journey. If you talk about cricket in Nepal, I think we're in this stage where, you know, we've just got ODI status. That's what, 2018. But I believe our first affiliation to international cricket was in 1996 when we first played the ACC trophy. That was in Malaysia. And we got the ICC affiliation. And then, you know, we became part of the whole cricketing family as such. And then after that, we've started to, you know, participate in ICC events. Cricket generally in Nepal has been played for a very long time. I think Cricket Association of Nepal itself was one of the first sports institution that was ever formed or established. That was back in, I think the Nepalese calendar dates around 2007, which is like a long, long time ago. But cricket generally became popular, I think, in the 90s, I would say. Growing up, I still remember watching, like, you know, Wasim Akram and Waqar Yunis, Sachin Tendulkar, you know, all these guys, the India-Pakistan rivalry that, you know, everyone knows about. And as a kid, we just were fascinated by all of this. So it's just been this whole roller coaster journey where cricket's been followed. We always wanted to have a cricket team that, you know, would participate in international events. And over the last 10 years, I would say, Nepal cricket's done exceptionally well. We've done well at under-19 levels. I remember back in 2002, in the under-19 World Cup in New Zealand, when we beat, we beat Pakistan and Bangladesh. I remember I was in school, I was listening to the news on the radio. You know, it was my first experience of the under-19 teams, you know, like beating a full-fledged test-playing country. And then after 2002, in 2004, I was part of the team in the under-19 frame where we beat South Africa in Chittagong, Bangladesh. And then in 2006, when we won the PAI Championship, we beat South Africa in the semis and then New Zealand in the finals, you know, and then players like Team Saudi, Martin Guptill, you know. I remember we beat Ireland and Owen Morgan used to play for Ireland then back in 2006 in the under-19 World Cup. And then slowly, steadily, till then our senior team was, reasonably, you know, going through the ups and downs. But I believe our first major trophy was back in 2010. Among the associate countries, we have this whole, World Cricket League structure as such. That's how it's termed today. And we were in Division 5 then. We won our first trophy. That was the tournament that was held in Nepal itself. And after that, I think we've slowly but steadily, gone through the international ranks. The real impact, I would really say, we made was when we qualified for the 2014 2020 World Cup. As a cricketer, I've always wanted Nepal and the people to follow and love Nepal cricket. But what happened was when we went into Bangladesh and when we played those three matches and when we came back, it was a completely different country. People loved us. I was in Bangladesh and I saw photos on social media with people in streets in large numbers gathered up to watch Nepal play. And that basically, I would say, changed the whole concept of what cricket means to Nepal. And we're here today. In 2018, we'll probably be one of the major, cricketing, I would say, a milestone here. Why? Because we attained ODI status. Without ODI status, as an associate country, you really don't get that recognition. So this has been the journey over the last, I'll probably say, 20 years.
While growing up, was cricket a viable career option? Because when I was growing up in India, my father was still skeptical, even though India was India and India is still India. The fact was that you knew that you were actually running a huge risk, and if you did not succeed, there was no fallback option. How was it like for you growing up in Nepal, wanting to be a professional cricketer, finding a livelihood in cricket? Was it difficult? Was it a viable cricket a career option?
It really wasn't a career, to be very honest. We played cricket because we loved the game. The passion was such that even cricketers before us, they played the game because we just fell in love with the sport. And I remember growing up, I was in school. My school's always been very, very supportive And we used to have this inter you know, house, what do you call those kind of matches, and our students versus teachers, you know, those kind of like matches against each other. And then again, cricket was something that was slowly growing up in the community where people were starting to follow cricket. Like I said, I mean, we've always followed international cricket, being close to India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh. So it was bound that cricket somehow, you know, managed to get into our cricket screen, into our TV screens. So that way cricket became popular. But if you talk about professionally, it's only been, what, 7-8 years? That's why I say 2014 World Cup was monumental. Why? Because I think that changed the whole concept as to how cricket changed and put a name across in the whole, I mean, put the Nepal in front of the whole world. Why? Because people started to relate it in a way where, like, you had your national anthem being played in front of thousands and thousands of, you know, worldwide audiences.
So can the young kids in Nepal now actually find livelihood in cricket? But now that corporates have started, there is T20 franchise-based tournament as well. Is there enough money at the domestic level, say even at the international level, put everything together? Is it enough for somebody to actually find a livelihood?
I think I would like to put it in this way. The one change that I have seen is, like, I started, like, from under 15s to under 17s to 19s to gradually to the senior level. So I remember when we were playing under 15s, that's like 2002, 2003. I had to, you know, I live in a place called Baneshwar. So I had to take a bus and get to a station, stop by and pick up another bus. And that led to our one and only international ground, that's TU International Cricket Grounds there. So the change that I see from then and now is, now I see parents bringing their kids, whether it's on a motorbike or even if it's in a public vehicle, parents have started to bring their kids, you know, to, you know, come watch them play. So that's a gradual change that I have seen. So that it in itself is a big mark, the change that I see as to, you know, how things have changed over the last 10, 15 years. But like I said, it's going to take a lot of effort in terms of managing things. Why? Because initially there weren't enough people to support it. Now we have the resources, we have enough corporates to back it up in the right possible manner. So that way, if we can invest into this game properly and set up a structure, set up a domestic structure where there's regular cricket, because Nepal, being the country that it is, we have a very good, I would say, a weather pattern, weather window pattern, where, like, probably if not for 2 or 3 months of monsoon, you can play cricket for 8 to 9 months. And that way Kathmandu itself is blessed with good weather. So with everything around us, if we get the right management in place, I believe Nepal cricket will definitely prosper. And professionally, I think there's been a lot of changes that has come into place. So it's all about now, you know, prioritizing what's important. The cricket team, which is functioning very well right now, to invest into them, into the youngsters now, setting up a structure where, you know, you can rely on. And again, it has to be a system where, like in India, you don't need to produce a cricket. There's a cricketer every second day that's being born. And for us as cricketers, if we get that exposure, I believe the talent is there to, you know, excel at the international level.
Has Sandeep Lamichhane, the leaps that he has taken, coming to the IPL, going to the CPL, Michael Clarke spotting him and all of that, has that changed something in terms of how cricket is now being perceived by the younger audience? T20s, IPL, it's been followed everywhere, and there is this one kid from Nepal who goes and makes a name for himself, and he's been appreciated everywhere. He's got serious talent. But I also remember you saying somewhere that he's not even the best bowler in Nepal at this point in time, but he gets that gig. So how much of a difference that Sandeep's now these exploits have made? And also, are there better bowlers than Sandeep in Nepal?
I think Sandeep probably is the best spinner in Nepal currently. And we've had spinners. I mean, we still have a spinner called Basant Rigby, which I believe who should have probably played the IPL. Even like if he was probably the best left-arm spinner at associate level. So unfortunately, I mean, it didn't work out for him. But having said that, right now, Sandeep's doing very well. And the change that I see is right now, you see kids, everyone wants to, you know, turn the arm over. Like I just went for practice, like just, you know, it's been what, couple of days after 80 days of lockdown. And I see youngsters even at the TU grounds, like the groundsmen who live at the ground themselves. There are a couple of young boys who want to, you know, they started to bowl leg spin. And I see that the whole impact that, you know, Sandeep's brought upon, where, you know, now people believe that if he can make it to the IPL, why can't I? So this is this whole concept where people have started to believe that a kid who's come from nowhere, who's representing Nepal, now is playing at the highest level and representing Nepal, representing his country in so many different leagues. So that way it's brought in that belief that, you know, it's possible. But again, there is talent in this country, and I've said this time and again, I have played against, if talk about 2004, you know, when I played my first Under-19 World Cup, I played against the likes of Alistair Cook, you know, Liam Plunkett. These are all part of the England, Ravi Bopara, this is part of the England squad. And then like Morgan, you know, and then Luke Wright, who's, you know, I just played with him in the T10 League in Abu Dhabi for the same team. I remember talking to him as well. And then over the years, you know, we have guys who played against some of the best players at Under-19 level and beaten them. But it's just about that exposure, that leap after the Under-19 levels. And without a structure, it's hard. Why? Because to become a good cricketer, what we have learned is you have to play against better teams. You have to get beaten day in, day out. And then you go through that grinding process and eventually you become a better cricketer. So for Nepal and I would say for all our cricketers, if we get that exposure at this stage, you know, and I believe we have a bright future. Provided we set up our own structure in a way, but the talent itself, if we put it into that cricketing environment, will definitely excel.
I think talent is not something that the southern Asian continent actually we struggle with. We have enough cricketing talent. Management in Nepal Cricket Association of Nepal, has it been managed well? What are the things that can be changed and should be changed for Nepal to actually become a force?
One of the things I would really like to mention is I think we haven't the pace at which the cricket team was functioning and the results that were being produced, the management actually couldn't, you know, cope up or at least stand by the results, you know, or go hand in hand or go step by step. So that is something I believe we couldn't, you know, match. But again, having said that, it was always about, it has to be our priority. See, for us as cricketers, when we go out there representing our country, we don't think of anything else. We just go out there, you put in 100% and then, you know, do your best to make sure that your country wins. So if you're into a management side of things, it has to come to a priority where if you hold a certain position in any management position, you should be accountable for what you do. So I believe that's where we have lacked. We haven't had enough people accountable for what they have done. So the results wise, yes, we always did well. We won here. You know, we managed to, you know, do well on a cricket field. But off the cricket field, has there been enough development? Is a very big question that we ourselves, we've been asking to our management. Unfortunately, over the last, 3.5 years, we got suspended as well from the ICC. There was a time when we were directly under the ICC and we were just going on tours. The funding was completely stopped. And just 8 months ago, we got reinstated. But that also under a clause where it says, you know, I don't know, it's a term that they use as some fund where they'll control the funding, but the suspension has been lifted, but not fully. So hopefully we can earn the respect back from the ICC. It's very important that for that to happen, we need to show some good groundwork level, some planning as to, you know, how we want to set up things. Right now would probably be a very tough situation because it's not just Nepal, it's the whole world that's, you know, suffering because of the COVID-19 situation. But I'm sure the Cricket Association of Nepal and everybody around it has learned its lessons. And it's about the game, I think, the kind of passion that the players have shown. That's the exact kind of passion that we need from the other side. And if these two actually come together, and we will definitely become a cricketing force to reckon with.
Paras, 10 years, a decade as a captain, the most successful Nepal captain, got the team to the one-day status. First batsman to score an ODI century for Nepal. First captain to score a century in a run chase in a T20 international. All of that. Fantastic. So well done on that for sure. But why suddenly, like when the suspension gets lifted, that is the time you give up on your captaincy. What exactly is happening there? Why do you not want to lead? You're only 32.
No, I think a lot of people have asked me about this. I think eventually it was about, you know, over the last 10 years of me becoming the captain, there were times when as players, we have gone against the association, where we have boycotted certain national tournaments, demanding, you know, cricket development has not gone in the right way. The players have not been treated, you know, in the right frame of mind. So there have been a lot of ups and downs with myself being the leader of the pack, where we've gone against the system. And there's always also this rumor that a lot of people put into us that cricket Association Nepal went into suspension because of the players, but which is false because it had to do with other monetary terms or other, you know, financial aspect or accountability or whatever that ICC had to do with Cricket Association Nepal. So for me, I think I wanted to give CAN itself a fresh start because for me myself, see, it's already been 10 years of leading the country for a person who actually never dreamt of, you know, representing Nepal. I got that opportunity to play for my country, and again to have got the opportunity to lead my country was a blessing. And the results have been possible because for me it wasn't about me, it was about the team, it was about this honest bunch of individuals who, you know, day in day out put in that effort, and that honesty, you know, produced the right results. And that way I believe that when the time came, it was about time that, you know, it had to be handed over to somebody. And for CAN to be reinstated, I think we didn't want to go into that whole huddle of, you know, whether who should be the captain, whether I should still be the captain. Because I remember even after giving up the captaincy, I did get calls from CAN saying, like, I think you should reconsider. But it was a personal based decision where I believe I myself wanted to enjoy, like, whatever remaining time period that I have, you know, to continue as a cricketer and just enjoy the perks of being a cricketer. But again, it's not that, not just important that you become a captain and you contribute to a team. I think any player can contribute. A leader is somebody who, you know, takes responsibility for his actions. So for me, I think even if I'm not the captain, I believe there's a lot more that I can add up to the Nepalese cricket team, and it's just about supporting each other. And in the end, it doesn't matter who the captain is. As long as we produce results on a cricket field, as long as Nepal is winning, that is what will matter to me.
Nepal look at the Asian bloc for development? And why I ask you this question is because Nepal is very strategically placed. We've got a very strong Asian bloc. You've got Bangladesh, India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka. Now Afghanistan is also making an impact. They're a test playing nation. Now Nepal is a one day playing nation. But do you expect a little more from the Asian bloc? Because if, as you earlier mentioned on this very interview, that you have to be beaten every time. Like every day you need to get beaten, and then you get up and then you become better. But that you can only become better if you're playing better countries. If you're only playing associate nations, how do you develop? So do you look at the bigger boys in the block?
We need that. We need to get that exposure. It's as simple as that. It's about setting up our domestic structure where we have our players from India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka come and play. And our players especially go into, you know, and play in all these leagues. I remember when, even before, like 1998, Bangladesh and Nepal played the ACC, you know, trophy finals in Nepal itself. And now Bangladesh is a full-fledged test playing country. And we haven't, you know, taken that break or that step from there. So we need that exposure when we have such cricketing giants all around us. We need our neighboring countries, I mean, if you know, to come out there and help us. Because the talent is there. Now it's just that exposure that I keep repeating this word, that Nepal cricket needs that exposure. So for us, if we get that exposure, I believe from our neighbors, I think cricket will definitely flourish in this country. Again, we have to have a system where our players, or maybe we can even have a team that goes and plays in, let's say, in the domestic Indian circuit, where, you know, we get that opportunity. There are state level cricket tournaments, and for a country to represent, you know, it doesn't have to be under a country's name. It could be a board president's 11 under a mutual understanding where you're playing regular cricket against some of the best cricketers. And you know how competitive cricket is in India. I mean, there are so many cricketers, so many good teams. So if Nepal can, you know, fit into one of the scheme of things, whether we go to Pakistan or Sri Lanka or Bangladesh or India, I think that should be our priority. Why? Because it has to be that we play against these better teams and better opponents for us to excel. And if we are to become a better cricketing nation on a cricket field.
How far is Nepal from becoming a test nation, Paras? Give me a long shot, a short shot, whatever. But what's your instinct saying?
If a 10 to a 12 year program, I see from, let's say, if it's 2020 now, right? If we put everything into place, because I see a lot of positivity around where how people are starting to respond to Nepal cricket and even in the country itself, because if in the end, the people inside the country have to, you know, recognize the sport and, you know, value it. So I believe because of the results that we have produced, it's going to take 10 to 12 years. And again, it'll come under ICC's provision as to how they want to, you know, give a test status to a particular country. But again, we have the biggest fan base. Our fan base is among the best in the world. If you talk about, we'd probably beat some of the best test playing countries. If you talk about viewership, if you talk about, you know, number of people that actually follow the game when Nepal cricket's, you know, on a cricket field. So that way, if we can set all of that up, I believe it's gonna take 10 to 12 years. I would love to see Nepal become a test playing country. I think that's one of my ultimate dreams. Unfortunately, I won't be part of it as a player, but I would like to play some role if I can from my part to make sure that Nepal reaches its destination. It's a dream. It's a possibility. If it was not possible, I'm not somebody who will just sit down and talk about it for something that's not possible. Because when we said we could achieve and reach a World Cup, most people laughed at us. And when we actually made it to a World Cup, people are like, yes. Now that we've got ODI status, people are like, okay, they've achieved this as well. But this whole journey of becoming a test playing country will take a lot of effort. It's not just the results on a cricket field. There's a lot of things that you have to, you know, tick the boxes, as they say, outside the cricket field. So we're following in the right pathway. It's a 10 to 12 year journey, and hopefully by 2032, maybe I'll be at one of the cricket grounds. Maybe it could be in our home cricket ground that we'll get to see Nepal play its first test match, or maybe it could be against India. Never know.
Fingers crossed, toes crossed. Hope that happens. Just the last question, Paras. It's about the situation right now. So COVID-19, how it's hit the world, it's come to a grinding halt and all of that. Most countries, every country is going to take a hit. We've seen Cricket Australia struggling. You've seen Bangladesh laying off people, or Afghanistan actually cutting the salaries by half. CPL has now come up with another reduction of player fee. So Cricket Association of Nepal, in these times when the funding is going to be an issue and sports actually is very low on the priority list, everything else is far more important than sports. So from that vantage point, that point of view, Paras, how much is it going to affect Cricket Association of Nepal, cricket in Nepal, that young kid who wants to pick up the bat, will he get the ball and bat to play? That's my bigger worry, bigger question.
I think it's something I won't be able to answer you right now, right away, because like I said, there are bigger priorities that needs to be taken care of at this stage of our lives itself. Cricket's a part of it. Cricket's brought a lot of smiles to a lot of people in this country. But again, right now, it's just people who are working every day, you know, to, you know, make Nepal a safer place. The health workers, the medical staff, the security people, you know, everyone around who are pushing themselves. So it's going to affect. I think COVID-19 has affected everything around it. So cricket's a part of it. I hope we can come out of it with a lot of positivity. Why? Because the only thing you can live by is hope. Hope is the only thing that keeps everyone alive. And as a cricketer, as a responsible citizen of this country, you know, all I like to address is we need to stay strong, stay positive. This is not going to be easy for any one of us, but we'll have to stick by it, stick together. And you know,
this shall pass
like anything else.
Chalo, thank you so much, Paras. Thanks a lot for doing this.
Thank you for, you know, this whole, for us as cricketers, you know, I think it's great that talking to somebody like you, I think it'll give Nepal cricket an exposure, and hopefully with the right platform, Nepal cricket will get that opportunity in future.
Yes, of course.